Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Maryhill Parish Church. It's lovely to have you all here this morning, both in the church and in the Zoom room. We're continuing our journey through the Gospel of Mark this morning and having a look at what Jesus teaches us about rest.
So I'm going to pass back to Nell now in the Zoom room.
Okay, so I'm going to ask Nell to do the opening prayer.
Good morning. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know what we need before we ask. You know too how foolish we can be in the things we do ask for. Care for us in our weaknesses. There are things we need which we don't feel good enough to ask for. There are things we need which we don't even see we should be asking for. Loving God, you care for us more gently and lovingly than we can understand. You care for us more ferociously and powerfully than we dare to hope. Heal our wounds this morning. Hear our prayers which we bring to you today. And may we be confident in our right to accept these gifts through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So let us all join together as he taught us, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. And we're going to now have a song by Stormzy, Blinded by Your Grace.
I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace, by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fixed me. Now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause, and one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith from the courts. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. No, I'm real talk, look at what God did. On the main stage, running around topless. My phone flips, then I tell him that we got this. This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, could you stop my verse? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood and it's not by birth. But oh my God, what a God I serve.
Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. Now I'm blinded.
Said a prayer this morning. I prayed I would find a way to another day. I was so afraid till you came and saved. You came and saved me. And the rain was pouring, 'cause the sun faded away. Now I'm in a better place, no longer afraid, blinded by your grace. You came. I prayed I would find a way to another day.
Okay, we're now going to have some Bible readings. The first one is Gary, which I'm going to read, and then Gary's going to read from Mark's Gospel. Psalm 23. The Lord our shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. He lets me rest in fields of green grass and leads me to quiet pools of fresh water. He gives me new strength. He guides me in the right paths as he has promised. Even if I go through the deepest darkness, I will not be afraid, Lord, for you are with me. Your shepherd's rod and staff protect me. You prepare a banquet for me where all my enemies can see me. You welcome me as an honored guest and fill my cup to the brim. I know that your goodness and love will be with me all my life, and your house will be my home as long as I live. So I'm going to ask Gary now to unmute and read Mark 6.
Mark 6, 30 to 34 and 53 to 56. The apostles returned and met with Jesus and told him all they had done and taught. There were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his disciples didn't even have time to eat. So he said to them, "Let us go by ourselves to some place where we'll be alone and you can rest a while." So they started out in a boat by themselves to a lonely place. Many people, however, saw them leave and knew at once who they were. So they went from all the towns and ran ahead by land and arrived at the place ahead of Jesus and the disciples. When Jesus got out the boat, he saw this large crowd, and his heart was filled with pity for them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. They crossed the lake and went to the land at Gennesaret, where they tied up the boat. As they left the boat, people recognized Jesus at once. So they ran throughout the whole region, and wherever they heard he was, they brought to him the sick lying on their mats. And everywhere Jesus went, to the villages, towns, or farms, people would take the sick to the marketplaces and beg him to let the sick at least touch the edge of his cloak. And all who touched it were made well.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to have another song by Carrie Job.
Still my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change, he faithful will remain. Be still my soul, thy best, thy heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still my soul, thy God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the thy confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my
Okay, I'm not going to pass to Ian to read the church.
Grand, thank you.
So,
I really feel for Jesus in this passage. It's a time when we particularly see his humanity. He's absolutely rushed off his feet, doing everything he can to help endless people. And all he really wants to do is have a bit of rest and peace and a bite to eat. He sounds tired, overwhelmed, and overworked. The need is great, yet Jesus knows that he can't go on indefinitely. And so he tells his disciples that he needs to go and find some rest, somewhere, somehow. What can we learn here, then, from Jesus about rest? Firstly, be realistic. Jesus is sensitive to the need around him. He doesn't just abandon everyone. In the verses which we missed out this morning, he fed the 5,000, which is hardly taking a break. He then does manage to hide away for a time of prayer, but doesn't even seem to get any sleep before he walks on water to help the disciples who are struggling against the waves. We then rejoined the story to find them immediately faced with crowds clamouring for healing. were hit straight away by the crowd's needs. There are so many people that the best many of them can hope for is a wee touch of the corner of his cloak. Just a few weeks ago, we read about the woman who had bled for 12 years. The fact that Jesus could feel the power going out of him when only one person in a whole crowd touched his cloak gives an idea of how draining so many healings must have been for him. Yet he continues nonetheless because his heart breaks for these poor people. So while Jesus puts importance on rest, he is still aware of the problems around him and responds to them. That said, Jesus does eventually take that all-important rest. Throughout the Gospels, there are mentions of him going away to a quiet place for prayer. If Jesus were to use a modern cliche, he'd tell us that you can't pour from an empty cup. We will never have the power or spiritual resources that Jesus had if he needed to take rest and spend time with God. Then, in order to keep healing and serving people, then we most certainly do. But maybe this past year makes you feel guilty about taking a rest. In previous years, this passage may have prompted us to focus on the busyness of our lives and feel God's blessing to stop a while. But for many of us, we've just been through a period of enforced rest. Yet, it's a rest that's not been very restful. Some have been locked into times of stress at work. They most definitely haven't been furloughed, and it's been all the harder to stop. Some have had less work responsibilities, but more childcare responsibilities, with fewer pastimes available to help fill the hours. And some have had the ultimate enforced rest. They had to stay home without visits or occasional outings to ease the weighty loneliness. But you know all of this. You have lived this. You have seen your loved ones live this. You can tell me as well as I can tell you that this is rest has not been restful. It has been emotionally draining. It has been so long since what we once called normal that maybe you can't relate to Jesus in this story at all. Why would he want to leave all those people? Why would he want to give up the chance of spending time laughing and joking with folk, listening to stories and being heard, discussing the problems of the day, or just sitting in that physical awareness of being part of a group of people, a community even? This has been so often lacking for us recently that we can forget how exhausted Jesus must have felt. We all need rest at times, and whatever your circumstances, you deserve a rest. Jesus called his disciples to rest then, and God still calls us to rest now. Yes, being with others can be joyful, nourishing, energizing to the soul, but so is time with God. You eat when you feel hunger, you go to the toilet when your bladder is full, and you go to bed when you can't keep your eyes open any longer. But do we listen to our soul's needs in the same ways? Do we recognize an ache or a sadness or whatever our own warning signs are that we're missing God from our lives? Making time for God sounds like just another thing to fit in, but doing so makes the rest of your schedule feel more manageable. If you wanted to put a modern label to today's passage, it would be that Jesus is modeling self-care. Jesus calls the crowd sheep without a shepherd. Sheep without a shepherd don't know where they're going and wander aimlessly. Sheep without a shepherd in Jesus' time and place wouldn't have been able to find food to keep themselves alive, which is hard for us to imagine in a place where abundant rain means that grass is everywhere. Sheep without a shepherd need to fear the dangers of the world surrounding them. Jesus is offering guidance, He's offering nourishment. He's offering security. When you are confident that you have these things, that is when you can begin to truly relax. We are sheep who have a shepherd. God is giving us permission to rest, safe in the knowledge that he is caring for us. We do not need to continually carry the weight of the world on our shoulders. And don't forget that we are a community. We care for one another. While this means that we help each other out, the flip side of that is that we need to accept help at times. God has given us one another, and we have never felt that as keenly as we have through this pandemic. If you're still hesitant about cutting yourself some slack, here's a selfless argument to add to my case. Taking better care of yourself allows you to better serve others. If you are refueled, you can't help but share with others. Whether it's a smile, a kind word, doing someone's shopping, truly listening to somebody when they need it, or any number of other acts of care, you are spilling out God's love and care for others. We read recently about Jesus sending out the disciples in pairs. They were told to take nothing with them, but that didn't mean that Jesus sent them out unequipped. Neither does God ask you to care for your community without support. He asks you to rest in him so that he can replenish and equip you for time with his people. This is true prayer. A life spent solely in prayer is lacking in real Christianity, just as much as a life never spent with God. Jesus could have spent all his days on earth in the temple or a quiet place praying with God. But what would he have achieved? What example would he have given us? True prayer leads to action. It leads to the kingdom of heaven being that bit more present on earth through what you do. The second song we heard today, Be Still My Soul, is a hymn you may know from RCH4. There's lots of beautiful lyrics in it, but the line, Be still my soul, the winds and waves still know his voice who ruled them while he lived below, stood out to me. It reminds us that more than once in the Bible, including in the verses which we missed out this morning, Jesus calms troubled waters and stills terrifying storms. In the same way, God calms our storms today. When things feel out of control and too overpowering for us, we must remember that they cannot overpower God. This is why there is peace in resting in God. He can carry the weight of all our worries and sadnesses. They aren't too heavy for him. Learning to lean into God allows you to put down your troubles and trust that he will pick them up. We can't know the future, but we can know that he has it in hand. And we can know that he is with us in the uncertainty of the present. Okay, great. I've convinced you to allow yourself some rest. But what if you're not that confident about praying? How do you get this replenishing prayer that Jesus found so restorative? Unfortunately, there is no silver bullet. All of our relationships are unique, and our relationship with God is no different. There is no right or wrong way to pray. There is only what is meaningful to you and what you feel brings you closer to him. Though there are lots of different ways of praying to investigate and explore. Pray as you can, not as you can't. Don't pour guilt on yourself for not using the right words or spending enough time in prayer, letting your mind wander, forgetting someone who you promised to pray for, or any other problem that you come up against. None of this will fill you up like God wants to fill you up. Do what works for you and trust that God will work with that. He loves you and he wants a relationship with you. You. here, now, as you are, not some perfect version of you which you hope to achieve in the future, who has it all together. He loves you. Let him. Amen. Therefore, let's pray together as we reflect on this. Lord Jesus, you have walked this earth. You have wept for the sorrows that we face in life. We know that we can bring you our troubles, and you will give us the strength we need to bear them. Today, we bring you the pains of our world. We pray for those affected by the flooding across Europe. We pray for an end to racism, that love and compassion will replace the hatred and ignorance in people's hearts. We pray for continued strength for our frontline workers as they continue day after day to keep our country running. We pray for health for those we know, including ourselves, who are sick in mind, body, or spirit. We pray for peace and stability in Afghanistan as the government handles the changing situation. We pray for wisdom for our leaders and courage to do the right thing. We pray for wisdom for ourselves in the leadership we have for others in our life. We pray for courage to be you for them. Lord Jesus, bless this world with your spirit. Amen. Now going to pass back to Nell.
Our last song this morning is Take Courage by Christine DeMarco. I'm now going to pass back to Iona in the church.
Thank you. So now just to close with a blessing. So now go ready to seek the peace of Christ, confident that you are held in his loving hand, and may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and all those who you love. Amen.